For most of human history, you would be lucky to have one single textbook, one precious learning resource that you would reread dozens of times. Today, there are hundreds, thousands, millions of books, videos, blog posts, and podcasts all trying to teach you something. We have an absolute embarrassment of riches. But that doesn't necessarily make learning easier. In some ways, having access to all of these resources is harder than, say, learning as an apprentice or learning from a single textbook. To be a really effective online learner, I try to answer the following questions. What learning resource should I use? Do I take a Coursera course or download a good textbook or fire up Khan Academy or make my way through a crash course on YouTube or find a good blog or download an app? There are lots of ways to evaluate these learning resources, but here's a couple of dimensions to consider. One question is this a learning resource aimed at beginners or is this for more advanced students? YouTube videos and online courses are often created to introduce a subject to provide some kind of basic foundation, while blog posts by specialists and textbooks can offer more nuanced, advanced takes on things. Another question is this a resource that focuses on rigorous definitions and procedures, or is it a resource that focuses on intuition and conceptual understanding? Often, you're looking for resources that complement each other. You can use one as a primary and another as a reference, or you could bounce back and forth between the two as you're learning the subject matter. Some people have also created amazing guides to the resources out there, like Susan Rigetti's Guide to Learning Physics. Another way to evaluate learning resources is to ask a different question. How am I going to be getting the right practice or experience? Many online courses are content heavy. They want to tell you a lot of stuff. And as students, we also tend to favor content over practice. It takes less effort to watch a video about physics than it does to sit down and do some physics problems. So when I look at an online course or a learning app, I think about where and when I'll actually be getting practice at something. What percentage of the time that I spend in the course is actually spent on answering questions, or solving problems, or getting practice at some skill, or applying some ideas? I want that percentage to be on the higher side. I also think about the value of the practice that I'm getting. Are these questions little dinky true or false, check your understanding questions? Or are they questions that are actually going to challenge me so that I can grow my skills? In some cases, the practice is already built into the subject matter, even in a content-heavy course. Andy from andyguitar.com presumes that you are sitting there with your guitar or your ukulele as you are watching his content. That is, you are practicing with him, before him, after him, and so some amount of practice is already incorporated into the course. But in other cases, you have to actually find those practice opportunities, or you're reliant on the teacher to provide you with certain practice opportunities. And again, this is where complementary resources come into play. Have a resource that explains things really well but doesn't give you any practice? That's great. Pair it up with another resource that gives you more practice but maybe doesn't explain things that well. Another question I like to ask about learning resources is, where can I interact with others? You can learn a lot by yourself, of course, but you can learn even more when you interact with other people. One kind of resource that we haven't talked about yet is the online forum. I'm looking for at least one resource that I'm using to have access to a vibrant community. Ideally, it's a place where I can ask questions and receive answers. But even just lurking on the forums or in the comment sections of videos can enrich the learning experience. People ask questions I wouldn't have thought of, and people provide answers that I wouldn't have thought of either. There are also other things to consider. Are people asking good questions? Do a lot of questions go unanswered? Are people interacting politely and respectfully? Is there a range of levels of expertise within the community? If everyone's a beginner, there might be more confusion than clarity. But if everyone's an expert, I might not understand the conversation in the first place. As I'm using these resources, I ask myself a couple of other questions. How am I going to spread my learning out? I'm almost always thinking in terms of long-term growth of skills, and spreading out our learning across time is important for this kind of goal. Once I commit to learning something, I think about what the next learning session is going to be like. What am I going to do during that time? And when is it going to happen? I don't want to cram everything in at once. Even subtle changes, like splitting a 2-hour reading session into 2 1-hour blocks, can have long-term benefits for learning. Fundamentally, I don't think of learning as shoving more information into my head. I think more of it like becoming really good friends with the topic. Another question, when am I actually going to use what I am learning? We talked before about whether a learning resource provides practice opportunities. More practice opportunities and better practice opportunities, well, that's good. But the practice that we're getting inside the closed environment of an online course is bound to be a little bit different than how we would apply what we are learning outside of that course. The math problems that you confront in school are different in important ways from the math problems that you might confront outside of school. You may have to write an essay in class, but it's still probably more constrained than the task of writing an essay in real life. Of course, the fact that there's a difference between in-app practice and out-of-app practice is often what makes the app good for learning in the first place. Simply Piano, for instance, does, I think, a pretty good job at teaching fundamental piano skills. And there's lots of practice involved. But the practice that you get during those courses is still a little bit different than actually playing sheet music or even accompanying other musicians. The pieces are shorter and simplified, and you get instant feedback, and you don't have to turn the pages, and you don't have to coordinate with anyone else. But the reason that they do that is to make things easier to learn. Still, I like to mix up my in-app practice with plenty of out-of-app practice. I never want to deceive myself into thinking that my performance inside the bounds of the course will be the same as my performance outside of those bounds. Now, I don't definitively answer these questions every time I go to learn something new. In fact, I think it's impossible to answer these questions in the beginning. Rather, these are questions that I ask myself periodically as I am learning something. What is this resource really helping me to do? Am I getting the right kind of practice? What else is missing? If you have other tips about online learning, please put them in the comments below so that other people can benefit from them, including myself. But you know what else helps us to learn effectively? Having internet access in the first place. It's easy to forget that there's about 1 billion people without internet access. So this embarrassment of riches that we take for granted, they've barely seen. That's why I'm trying to raise awareness for an organization called GiveInternet.org. They provide internet access to students so that the students can get better jobs, they can contribute to their communities, and they can learn cool new skills. There's 3 reasons why I like GiveInternet.org. The first is that they are close to the problem. The group still works out of Tbilisi in Georgia and has helped students in Georgia for years before they branched out into new areas. And when they do move into new areas, they find partner organizations that they can trust and adapt their processes to meet local needs. Currently, they work in refugee camps and with some of the most underserved communities in Kenya, Uganda, Nigeria, Lebanon, India, and Georgia. The second reason I like them is that their leadership learns over time. So the group began in Georgia translating Khan Academy videos into Georgian. But then they realized that many Georgians did not have internet access in the first place to even take advantage of these translated videos. So they focused on what they saw was the more fundamental problem. The third reason that I like them, and probably the most important reason, is that GiveInternet.org is not interested in just throwing the internet at someone and walking away. They work with students to connect them to educational resources and, together with partner organizations, fill gaps in educational systems. So for instance, a student at a refugee camp may go to school for a few years, but then when they return home without a computer and without internet access, they can't continue their education. That's where GiveInternet.org steps in. So if you have a few bucks lying around and you want to give students educational opportunities that they otherwise wouldn't have, donating to GiveInternet.org is a great way to do it. And if you donate through my link below, your donation will be matched, so you'll be able to double the impact that you will have. That's it. Thanks for listening. I'll see you next time.